the doctorate at Gran Sasso Science Institute. So, well, okay.
So thank you very much. Thank you very much. Professor Ricciardi, my name is Francesco. I'm very glad to be here, and I'm glad of this occasion of getting along with you. I think that somehow it's clear that I'm old, so this is why I'm lecturing. You are young because you are listening, but this is not a very good somehow attitude. In my view, we should recognize that we are trying to do research and to learn interesting things, and this is the spirit of the lecture. So this is I'm going to lecture on neutrinos, which is a big subject. It concerns both particle physics, astrophysics, and several say nuclear physics, etc. Standard model, beyond the standard model, I assume that you know the standard model already. I think it's a good approximation. Also, you had a professional lecture on that. And so the lecture plan I'm proposing is this one, is an introduction today. Then tomorrow I'm going to lecture on this feature of neutrino, that they change flavor, change type during propagation. It's called oscillation with some jergal term. Then a few neutrino sources, natural one will be the topic of the third day, and the observation, detector, and all that. Then there will be a lecture on artificial sources and introduction to data analysis. You had already a very nice lecture by Luca Lista on that topic. This I propose also to have some practical session there, so the construction of likelihood, analysis of simulated data, and all that. So this is the fourth lecture. And then last one is on theoretical aspects beyond the standard model, say, and say a bit of cosmology and other issues. So you see, I'm beginning. I don't know you, and you don't know me. I hope that in this time we pass together, we will have occasion to know each other and to learn something useful. So today is introductory matter. So again, I will not probably teach you something. I will not teach you something very modern. So I'm trying to go back to, say, origins and point out some interesting aspects which somehow maybe deserve a bit of emphasis. So this is, in a sense, I'm trying to cover some general aspects and trying to go to the point. And then during the discussion, we will get together to Blackboard, and we can develop things. I will propose a lot of exercises. This is not, I mean, in the sense that I'm supposed to somehow annoy you, but the idea is just to trigger discussion. Now, if something is interesting you, or you realize, oh, this maybe I better know, so we can try to solve them and to begin a discussion about that. So, beginning of first lecture, so evolution of our idea concerning the matter. So somehow we have idea, theories. Now we call theory, but this could be called model theory. Elementary particle and laws governing their transformations. So this is really very general. So general that I begin talking about atoms. So this is Jean Perrin, and you see a paper of him in French. It was in fact a popular paper in the beginning of in 20th century, so it's 1901, no? Where he describes what we call, say, a planetary model. So you see the word there. He speaks of the model of atom with some sun, a soleil in the center, and then some planets, which are these negative charged planets turning around. So you see this is at least 10 years before Rutherford. This is, in fact, what we are used to call. And this was basically the model of matter that we had in that time. So somehow, scientists were asked what's matter, and they probably answered something like this. Now, let me go to the continuation of story. So the discovery of radioactivity shows that there is some phenomenon which concern the nucleus, so it has much more energy than atomic transition, so there is some dynamics inside this nucleus. Then there is the discovery of alpha, beta, gamma ray, that is these emissions, and you see, I mean, it's a fun aspect is that we call alpha, beta, gamma even today, but this is in a sense like calling things X, Y, Z. I don't know. So, but in a sense, this is this belongs to a time when things were discovered, but we should not be tricked by or confused. I will show you that this terminology can be confusing. Then a very shocking discovery was the one of the chemist Soddy working with Rutherford, that you can have a transmutation between nuclei. One chemical element become another chemical element. This was a full shock, no? Because I mean, what you expect is that matter is forever, basically. This was the idea that was kept along since Democritus' time, at least. So, and this is the first time when matter apparently can transform, no, elements can change. Then energy mass equivalence, Einstein, and then eventually the nucleus is experimentally discovered by Geiger and Mersenne in the so-called Rutherford experiment. Now, suppose we are at this time, let's make theories now. So matter is thought to consist of atoms with nuclei, and with Einstein we have a first understanding of light or quanta. It took 20 years to be accepted fully, this idea of atom of light, so photons we call it today. Now, let's consider this question. No? Suppose that we know that there are nucleus of various type, and we ask why not, why we should not imagine, so we know that there are transformation, why an alpha nucleus, we could say an helium nucleus, should not transform into a couple of protons? Charge is conserved, we know energy is transformed, E equal mc squared, you expect a big emission. So let's go to lab, let's search for that. So the fact, in fact, I mean, I think it's a legitimate question. No? You have your model of matter, nuclei, atoms, and all that. This, you know that transformation can occur. Why this one is not taking place? Probably the answer will be something like mass number is conserved. You know, there is this Prout hypothesis that the nuclei have more or less some integer multiple values, more or less, no? So there is a nuclei with weight 1, 2, 3 in units of protons mass. And then there is these people somehow stating a law, this is this radioactive displacement law, which says that the mass number does not change, more or less. Okay, no, it changes a bit, we know, but these integer values do not change. So in a sense, we do not know why, but we state the law. Okay, there is another level of discussion, which is this one. No, one could try to have a model of matter, no, of nucleus. One should say, okay, I see the law, but why this law works? What's the mechanism? Can we understand how nucleus is built? And this was the next level of discussion. So the people I found which somehow made the first model, an interesting model of nuclei, are these two, a lawyer and a chemist. I mean, you are not laughing. This is fun. By the way, my daughter is a chemist. I'm really destroyed because of that. Yeah. Okay. So, Van der Broek, so at the time, you know, but I mean, I'm joking, of course, because you know that so many. Fermat was a lawyer. Fermat was a lawyer, and in a sense, he gave some good contribution to science. So, I have nothing against lawyers, because they are a bit dangerous. Anyhow. So let's come back to Van den Broek, this person who suggests that nuclei are formed by alpha nuclei and beta nuclei. You see emission from nucleus, and then you can postulate that the nuclei are built upon alpha and beta. Harkins proposes a little change of that, that is protons, basically what we call proton after Prout and the beta particle. And this is a good somehow guess. The mass is provided by proton, which is about 2,000 times heavier than electron. We know perfectly know that beta particle is an electron. This was measured by Thomson already. And then by putting together and supposing that something is tying, is bounding this nuclei, this is fine. This is an elegant and intelligent model. And they forbid this alpha decay into a couple of protons. On the other hand, this model, as you perfectly know, I'm sure you know it, contradicts some observational aspects of the so-called beta decay. What's beta decay? Beta decay is emission of electrons, so it's one type of nuclear decay. So an electron is measured at beta ray with all the terminology, and you expect that since initial nucleus, a finite nucleus, has a given mass, the energy of beta ray should be always the same. It is not. Sometimes it's more, sometimes it's less. Okay? So it's so-called continuous spectrum. Okay? So this theory leads you to think that you have a monochromatic beta ray as it happens to gamma ray emission, as it happens to alpha ray emission, while beta rays are continuously emitted. Now, we are in already 1930, and Pauli, a famous Austrian scientist, proposes a variation of the model by van der Broek and Harkins, which I draw there with this little billiard ball. Okay, so red is a proton, green is an electron, and then he postulates there is some gray, chargeless particle, very light one, and he says, according to my speculation, I postulate that nucleus is formed by proton, electron, and this new particle. Let's call it neutrino. I mean, he uses another name, but it's not the point. So this model can indeed account that when, the, for instance, tritium disintegrates, it forms helium-3, a beta ray, but a bit of energy is stolen by the other particle, the chargeless or almost invisible one. Okay, so this model can account for the continuous spectrum, no? And let me somehow just underline an aspect of this model. So, I mean, you may find it disgusting. I mean, in a sense, we are not just not acquainted, but on the other hand, if you go from somehow the past to present, and you have to devise some, you have to invent some idea, it's reasonable. So he says, he proposes, by the way, this model explains also why spin of nuclei are what they are. For instance, if you take nitrogen 14, nitrogen 14, according to, say, this model, has 14 protons, 7 electrons, 7 neutrinos, so it is integer as it is. The model without neutrino instead finds that this should be a fermion, not a boson. Okay, so this model has at least two good features. Okay, also another aspect which is characteristic of this model is that particles are forever. In a sense, you see, you can remove or bring it back to nucleus, but you don't lose particle. Matter particles are forever. What was thought to be, say, eternal, I mean atom, this property is transferred to particles. So the true atom will be the particles. The particle, and according to Pauli, this is to be thought. Now, let's consider instead the model theory, so which is instead put in mathematical form by Enrico Fermi 3 years later. No? So this is a theory where you postulate a new particle. By the way, this was observed. So Fermi was genius. This is no discussion. But I mean, this model was possible because neutron was discovered and not predicted. Huh? So anyhow, once you believe neutron is there, then Heisenberg, Ivanenko, Majorana discussed that nucleus is made by proton and neutrons. No, and then basic process of disintegration, of beta disintegration, is this one. Now, this process conceptually is completely different from the previous one because, I mean, you see, in the previous process, particles are forever. In the new process, particles appear and disappear. So you have a neutron in initial state and non-neutron in final state. You have, I don't know, an electron in final state and no electron in initial state. So this is something to which we are completely acquainted. But this is the difficulty when we communicate with laymen. I mean, whenever we try to explain what we are doing, no? So you say, oh, you know, oh, the particle appear, particle appear. Oh, yeah, what? So somehow the problem is this is a key conceptual problem or a big change. Eh? And this I want to stress. So this belongs to the same conceptual, say, framework as the theory of Einstein of photons, or you say light quanta. No, I mean, one of the reasons why this theory was not accepted was that a particle could appear and disappear. So when you have a photoelectric effect, for instance, no, according to Einstein, you have a particle which then is not anymore there. It's not that it's eaten or hidden inside the atom. It disappears. So this is, in a sense, this is the best we have. By the way, Feynman was very somehow shocked. He tried to explain to father. I mean, this is another story. I will tell you if you want. Still, let's then accept this point that we know perfectly and recognize, however, that this kind of position of Fermi lead us to new questions, new dilemmas. For instance, once we recognize that particle can appear, disappear, we are led to answer to question somehow to wonder why something happens, something does not. For instance, proton with charge unity, in principle, could decay into a positron and a quanta, I don't know, a photon or whatever you want, neutral particle, energy will be conserved, the charge will be conserved. Why not? Why this should not occur? Eh? So, I mean, in a sense, once you open the door of the Pandora box, I mean, you are led to wonder. And then people like Weil, Stuckelberg, and also Wigner later, again, postulate a law. There is a law which is equivalent to the one that we already stated, this Russell, Soddy, and Fajans law. The mass number is conserved. We could say the number of heavy particles is conserved, baryon number. It's just a name. It's just a statement that there is a class of heavy particle, a class of light particle, like, say, electron, a positron counting minus one, and you conserve both heavy particle type, baryons, light particle type, leptons. Okay, but this is not an explanation of anything. It's just, in a sense, a summary of observations. You do not know for sure that this is not there. So, summary. So, this very rapid discourses of all the results has recalled us that modern theory includes the possibility that particles appear and disappear. In this sense, the theory, as I already told you, the theory of photoelectric effect is closer conceptually to Fermi theory. And if you read the paper of Fermi, it's clear that just in the introduction, he states this kind of point, so that he takes inspiration. No? Let me show you it in, say, more graphical form. No? So this is a piece of a Feynman diagram. You see the amplitude of the transition. This is a piece of Feynman diagram where you have an emission of a photon or an absorption of a photon, the amplitude is proportional to the wave function of, so for instance, initial electron, initial photon, and final photon, and then correspondingly you have the time evolution of the wave function, which eventually leads us to energy conservation. No? So somehow the reason, by the way, this is a very key, very basic object which show you the connection between complex wave function and the description of particles. So this corresponds perfectly to the theory of Yukawa of a nuclear interaction. No? That is the hypothesis that there is a quantum which transform proton into neutrons, but you see, conceptually, is really identical. And again, Yukawa is inspired by Einstein. You see, I mean, it's really the same thing. So we just replace a pion with charge. Let me also remark that these two aspects, when you change the pion to initial state, you go from particle to antiparticle, no? As a general rule. So in a sense, this feature of particle transforming and changing, appearing, disappearing, is a relativistic feature, is a feature of quantum relativistic theories. So we should attribute to this quantum field theory this possibility of creating, of having antiparticle and of creating and destroying a particle. Now, to resume the facts that we know, we postulate certain laws, including, for instance, baryon number. We would be led to think that there is something similar for light particle. But let me just stress for the while that this could be either an observational law or some law which which holds in a certain theory and not in other theories. So somehow this law is going to hold or not depending on which is the frame of discussion we are considering. So this is too general. You know perfectly that there are theories which go beyond the standard model where baryon number does not hold, a lepton number does not hold. In this lecture, I will insist more and emphasize on those where lepton number does not, but we may go back and I will be glad to discuss also the other one. So first proposal of exercise. So this is so general, you don't believe I could give an exercise, but let me try. So let's assume that this theory of electron and proton model for nuclei are right, or the one of Pauli is the same. We know that the size of proton is about 1 Fermi, which is 10 to minus 15 meter. I'm used to CGS. I hope that this will not be a problem for you. I will often use centimeter. So what are the difference with an ordinary neutron? So somehow, in this theory, what are the properties that we predict for neutron, okay, in this theory? So in particular, estimate the spin and also magnetic moment and compare with value which are measured, okay? So then, this is, serious. The other one is speculative. Which force could bind, electron and neutrino? Could you imagine a force which binds electron and neutrino? Try to estimate the size of the kinetic energy of the particle. Okay, is it clear? If you want, we can discuss this one. Giulia, dimmelo. Giulia, you should answer. Okay, with this something, if you like, we can discuss now, later. I think that this is going to be recorded, so I better bring discussion to the end. Giulia, you tell me what we should do. So then this is a proposal for discussion. Now, okay, this is very general introduction. And then let me discuss now how certain ideas which are important for understanding neutrino have been understood and worked out. I think that some of these points were covered already by Luca Silvestrini, you certainly know them, so let me then flash on that. So in this bluish thing are the points I'm going to discuss. So in 35, muon is discovered in cosmic radiation. In 36, sorry, after Yukawa proposed this theory of pion as the mediator of a strong interaction. So some people start to say, maybe this is the particle that Yukawa postulated. Now, again, in Japan, a few years later, students of Yukawa, Sakata and Inoue, postulate a second neutrino. This may be shocking for some of you, but if you read the paper, it's published in English a few years after the war, but in Japanese it's in 42. And by Google Translate, I could check. I checked that this was in fact the same paper. they postulate that there is a second neutrino, not only the one associated to electron, but another one associated to this muon, basically. So he postulate that muon is not the same as pion, muon is associated to a new neutrino. Very interesting. So for instance, he writes, so this formula there is, y is the Yukawa quantum, the pion, basically. No, you see there, no, y decaying into m, which muon, and then is the neutrino associated to muon. Then the muon is going to decay into electron, ordinary neutrino, and electron one, and the new neutrino. I mean, it's not clear the separation between neutrino and the neutrino anyhow, but this is pretty interesting. Now, the experimental proof that the muon is different from Yukawa particle occurs later in 45. Then Marshak presented an idea in West similar to Sakata, but does not introduce a second neutrino. So he says, I don't know, maybe there is just one neutrino doing the whole job. So, I mean, there is only one neutrino. In a sense, it's more economical. It's less theory inspired, but in a sense, it's more economical. Soon later, however, there was a proof that indeed the two meson theory is correct. So, saying two meson is Yukawa quantum, pion, and muon. So, pion interacting strongly, muon not. So I'm sure this one you see in Luca Silvestrini lecture. This is so-called Puppi triangle. But let me continue with the history. So Bruno Pontecorvo focuses on theory of weak interaction, and then he checks that the absorption of electron and absorption of muon is called electron capture. Muon capture have the same amplitude. Then he starts to imagine that maybe there is some sort of universal weak interaction. We call it, in the time it was called the universality. Today we know this should be attributed to the fact that weak interaction is like is a gauge theory. There is an universal coupling, this G coupling, which is as universal as the electron charge. So we are not surprised that say electron and mu have the same electric charge and also the same weak charge. In the same manner we are not surprised, but this is the first evidence that was obtained. So then Puppi proposes this theoretical scheme, and let me just remark, you know, that so this resembles the Sakata model, and this say upper vertex is almost correct. So not completely correct. No, so it's not that neutron transform exactly into proton in a weak interaction. You know why? This you should know from Luca. I mean, we know, so okay, please tell me if you get the point. Bye-bye. I'm asking something somehow basic. So we know that electron correspond exactly to electron neutrino, by definition. So how can I say? The neutrino which corresponds to electron is the electron neutrino. But in weak interaction, in a sense, the weak current does not link exactly neutron to proton only. I would say in modern language, in standard model, we know the answer, no? We would say that U goes into D plus S, etc. No? In the old language, we could say that neutron indeed could couple to, say, lambda, whatever, no? I mean, okay, this took time to be understood well, but this is just to be sure we know what we are discussing, no? Eventually, the muon neutrino was observed in 62. So you see that after the proof was obtained 20 years later, a Nobel Prize was given to Lederman and the other two colleagues. Now, still, I repropose the same dilemma, no? So if you have a muon, why muon should not disintegrate into electron and neutral quanta, no? And this was a thing which was discussed. And you may check, and if you play a little bit with a loop diagram, you may check that if you have just one neutrino, like Marshak was postulating, you can produce a Feynman diagram where this indeed happens. So if you have only one neutrino, you are not able to get rid of that. This should be there, and it is not. Okay, so indeed this was a point in favor of the fact that there are two neutrinos, and there is a law which is called electron-lepton conservation, another law, muon-lepton conservation, another one. After we discovered tau-lepton conservation. So there is a tau neutrino corresponding to, et cetera, no? But in that time, we have just a law. So Konopinski, Mahmoud, and other people, and Max, which is not the famous Max, and not either the comedian, but was a serious physicist. Now, another point, V minus A. I mean, at the time when we studied with Professor Ricciardi, you know, this was a normal terminology. Do you understand if I say V minus A, or is it, yeah, sure, okay? So it's a vector minus axial. It took a little time to be understood, but let me just point out a piece of the history which is interesting. So concerning pions, okay, pion decay, no? Now, depending on which is the operator, the form of the operator, of the current for hadrons, somehow whether this is a scalar, vectorial, tensorial, whatever it is, there is different prediction for the ratio between the pion decay into electron and pion decay into muon. So I'm using modern terminology. This is, again, this is the Yukawa quantum, but I mean, you understand. So then theorists make prediction in 49 concerning this process, and then they compare with the experiment. Now, pion parity was measured by Steinberger and collaborator, and then again Steinberger measure, this is interesting, that the rate of pion decay into electron was very, very small, so this would rule out V minus A theory. Very interesting. So there was a moment of history when it was thought that we have experimental proof that the theory is not V minus A. Interestingly, Sudarshan and Marshak, and after Feynman and Gell-Mann, say, we don't believe that. So we say, theory says that this is V minus A. Beautiful. This is one of, say, moment when theorists are useful. I mean, I hope that I hope that you will have something similar in your career. And then finally, Fazzini, a collaborator, showed that this is indeed, so V minus A eventually is on solid experimental ground. Now, another point which you certainly know, the measurement of the spin of the neutrino. And in fact, more precisely, the spin of the neutrino in relation to its momentum. You see that according to standard model, but this was not known yet, according to V minus A theory, extended to lepton sector, the neutrino should have the spin in opposite direction as the momentum. As we say, technically, it's negative velocity. Okay, negative velocity means that this. Now, how can you measure this when neutrino is invisible in good approximation? So the idea was that you have electron capture of a certain type of nucleus, which eventually decays emitting a photon. Now, by checking that the final state photon is always polarized in a certain direction, you see that you have no choice but admitting that the neutrino is negative polarized. So this is a beautiful experiment of Goldabris. I mean, this is really a cartoon-like version. It's much more subtle, but this is the key idea. So the connection between negative velocity and V minus A, the property of strong interaction, the property of the weak interaction concerning hadrons, V minus A is connected with this property of velocity. Now we have basically after this moment, where as you have seen, I have emphasized the lot neutrino, in a sense we have the pillars of the standard model. So let me now admit that we have something like the standard model, but making connection with what you have seen now. No? Now, this is a famous picture you certainly have seen in a cartoon version by Fermilab, and I will insist a bit on that because I think it's very useful for us. So standard model has some feature. You can prove as a theorem that the baryon number and lepton number are symmetry, and then there are correspondingly conservation laws. Baryon number is conserved, lepton number are conserved in the standard model. They are accidental, all you want, but this is a theory. No? And as you see, this goes back to old times. Now, after the discovery of parity violation in the standard model in the mid of 50s, another hypothesis was invoked to somehow understand what was going on, that neutrinos are massless, and then there is this illicit feature. This was beginning of this V minus A theory, what we call today the chiral structure of the standard model. So this 1 minus gamma 5 goes back to these times, and then this massless neutrino playing a role in that. So do you want to stop a bit, or should I continue? For me, we are just chatting, basically. So, again, a standard model feature and proof that it has to be extended. So let me, again, consider this picture that now I make larger. No? So you see what this picture is emphasizing, that the particle with strong interaction, which are red, are on the top side. The particle with, say, without strong interaction are in another color. And you see, it emphasizes also that matter and antimatter is completely distinct. No? So, I mean, this mirror type feature is just explaining layman, you see, be sure we have antimatter, and this is not the same as matter. No? Now, if we, however, consider critically this picture, no, we may admit that a u-quark and the u-antiquark are different because they have different charge. No? But you may also wonder why neutrinos should be the same, different as antineutrino. Charge is zero, okay? I mean, a layman, which will be somehow critically trained, should ask that, no? So the answer will be, guy, in the standard model, neutrino and antineutrino are distinct. Let me elaborate a bit this point. Let me show you. This is key point for next discussion, because, I mean, I will try to argue that neutrino and antineutrino could be the same in a certain sense. Okay, let me again repeat the standard model on the structure. So, as you see, I emphasize that the difference between the total lepton number L and baryon number B is exact. It's not just, say, an accidental symmetry conserved in perturbation theory, but it's just exact. In the standard model, this is not violated even beyond the perturbation theory. And even the difference of lepton numbers is exact. Now, again, part of the standard model is that the neutrino with charge zero and the antineutrino have the different property. The spin of neutrino is counter the velocity of the momentum, while for antineutrino is the opposite. No? However, this definition, in a sense, so in a sense, this is an intrinsic definition of the difference between neutrino and antineutrino. You may say this connection between spin and momentum distinguishes the two. No? On the other hand, you may say, guys, this is fine if neutrinos are massless as they are in the standard model, okay? But let's consider the possibility neutrinos are not massless, not exactly, no? Now, if neutrinos are not massless, they have a rest system. Okay, what happened there? Indeed, there is a phenomenon which was observed and proved, it was predicted by Pontecorvo and other people, it was discussed by other people, which somehow can be explained, we will discuss it tomorrow better, can be explained assuming that neutrinos are massive. No? So here I'm supposing that I produce an electron neutrino in some manner, for instance, a neutron decay. Then if I think to this state as a superposition, quantum superposition of state with given mass, since the masses are different, the phase of are different during propagation, the sign, the relative sign changes, and final state could be a bit mu neutrino. So if neutrino are massive, and if the neutrino that we know are superposition of state of given mass, you may have something like this, and you observe something like this. So So this is observed. So indeed, this is considered proof that neutrinos are massive. Okay, I'm sure you knew it already. Eh? I'm just touching. But let me just stress the conceptual point that the evidence for neutrino mass shakes the foundation of the difference between neutrino and antineutrino. So let me make it even more clear in picture. No. So again, the definition of what is a neutrino and antineutrino, you may give it like that. So if you have a finite state positron, the neutral particle which is there is a neutrino, so that the lepton number is unchanged. No. So you have an light antiparticle and a light particle. So net number is zero. While if you have an electron, the neutral particle which we produce, for instance, in this beta decay, is an antineutrino. This is a definition. So apparently we can distinguish neutrino by antineutrino. And okay, this is to make the point even more clear. So for instance, if you have deuterium fusion, you have two protons fusing deuterium, so electron charge is conserved, the baryon number is conserved, the lepton number is conserved as well. So this is standard model feature, no? So then we will be led to think that neutrino are matter particle and antineutrino are different. However, let me come back to this point. As I told you, let's go to rest frame. No, so this is in the relativistic frame. If we go to rest frame, you do not have any more have the momentum. You have only the spin. So once you have the spin, rotation invariance would suggest that these two particles, which are both neutral, with similar property, will be the same. And this is the theory of Majorana. The theory of Majorana basically consists in the hypothesis that neutrino and antineutrino are the same particle in the rest frame. Okay, so let me say more precisely. Massive neutrino eigenstate will be indistinguishable by massive antineutrino eigenstate. Okay, this is in words or with some picture. I will be more precise in the technical part later on, but just to introduce the idea. So the fact is that helicity is a good point, in a sense. If particle is massless, you cannot remove the momentum. So you have the distinction between neutrino and antineutrino. No? If the particle is massless, you do not have the rest frame. Rest frame does not exist. And then you can say that neutrino are different from antineutrino. You have always the momentum. It's like a pole dancer, no? I mean, you have pole dancer, you can go here or can go there. If you have always the pole, you can say whether you are rotating here or there. If you do not have the pole, no way. Now, exercise to help the discussion. So I used some billiard ball things. You know perfectly from university lecture that this is not a good idea. The truth is that it's a good idea if you know somehow what you are doing and you do not overdo, in a sense. Okay. So I propose, however, to have a discussion. No? So what are the limits of somehow representing the electron as a billiard ball? Why we should not do that? So you want to discuss? If you like, we could discuss that. Why we should not? So, in fact, this is an interesting point, no? Because Pauli, which was aware of this problem, did not get immediately the point of spin. So somehow he said, no, cannot be. So, but eventually he's also the person who invented the spin. So, same question is for photon. No? For instance, if you say photon is a spin one particle, no, you say we are taught by quantum mechanics lecture, no, that you should have L equal one, you should have 2L plus 1 state. So it's 1, 2L plus 1 is 3. But you know that photon has 2 states, not 3. Why? You know why? You certainly know. Eh? Gauge invariance? Or? Yeah, because you have always the momentum. So in a sense, the point is that, if you want, mathematically, the representation of Lorentz group for massive state and for massless state are not the same. So what we are taught in university concerns atomic physics, which is mostly non-relativistic. No? So usually, the kind of things we discuss there do not concern even we do not talk of photons typically in a quantum mechanics lecture in the initial one. This was how quantum mechanics was understood. On the other hand, a situation like, say, photons, say, quantum electrodynamics, or even neutrinos, which is so fast, usually require us to understand the quantum mechanics a little bit better. So this is why I'm stressing this kind of consideration. Okay. So let me now tell you something a bit more advanced. So what is the current status of global number? Now we know from this oscillation that we'll discuss tomorrow in technical term that it happens that when you produce a muon neutrino, which according to standard models would be an eigenstate, because neutrinos are massless, can transform into electron neutrino. This is proven experimentally. Whatever the theory, this is a fact. And likewise, also, you can produce a muon neutrino and eventually obtain a tau neutrino. This was tested in CERN to Gran Sasso experiment. There is a list of experiments there we will discuss. Now, by checking this electron, muon, and tau lepton number, you see that all lepton numbers are violated. L, L mu, L tau are all broken experimentally. Okay? Lepton number is not, because muon neutrino going to tau neutrino, not antineutrino, and the same for the other one. Now, let me make another point which could be interest you as a theorist. So we know that the lepton number is not an exact symmetry of the standard model. One way of illustrating the point graphically is this one. If you take the current associated to baryon number, you take the divergence of this current, this should be zero if the symmetry, if the current is conserved. But if you check in perturbation theory, this diagram in particular, it is non-zero. So then divergence of baryon number is non-zero. So baryon number is not exactly conserved. Okay, this is called anomaly. Anomaly means I expect that the symmetry is there, but when I somehow play quantum mechanics, I check that it is not. However, this is very interesting because, as I wrote there, baryon number is not conserved, but the difference between B and L are. So B minus L is anomaly free in the standard model. As you see there, no, this is very interesting. No? The difference of L and L mu, which also is anomaly free in the standard model, is broken. So this is, in a sense, an interesting theoretical piece of information in theory, no? That an asymmetry which we think to be exact is violated. This is not minor beyond the standard model fact. So this I'm telling that these facts should be considered as serious information on beyond the standard model physics. I would say even the only experimental grounded fact on beyond the standard model physics. Because, I mean, we believe that dark matter exists, but we do not have the proof that the standard model exists. We believe that we should have a theory of quantum gravity, but we do not yet have a theory of quantum, etc., etc. So instead, we believe the standard model is correct, and it is not. B minus L instead is not violated by these processes, no? Because you see baryon number is zero, lepton number is unchanged. So in a sense, what I'm telling you is that this symmetry of the standard model, the only one which possibly survives is this B minus L. So this is I'm stressing to you, and I think it's pretty important, and it's important. Tests. So somehow, graphically, experimental tests of B and L, for instance, the possibility, the speculation that proton might disintegrate into, say, neutral pion, for instance, and the positron, and the possibility that nucleus changes the number of neutrons by 2 units. So 2 neutrons becomes 2 protons, and 2 electrons are also emitted. Charge is unchanged, spin is okay, all is fine, lepton number is broken. Okay? So these are the laws that we know, baryon number, the initial at the final state, you see they are changed, so that the first process is usually called a proton decay. I mean, it's pretty obvious, and so it's interesting to test this beyond the standard model landscape. And the second, probably you would like to call electron creation process, even if it is called differently in jargon. Okay? And the second is even more interesting because B minus L is violated. So this will test the only symmetry of the standard model, which is currently untested. Okay? Both of them are very actively searched. With a proton decay searched at Dune experiment in EOS, this one is searched in Grand Sas and in other places in the world. Its name, I mean, for those of you who know already a bit of neutrino, it's called neutrino less double beta decay. I am furious with this name, neutrino less double beta decay. I mean, I tell you why I'm furious. When you say beta decay, you are thinking to a time when electrons were beta rays. I mean, and electrons were thought to be in the nucleus. Okay? So you are using a language of a time where we thought that electrons live in the nucleus. And you define something which is neutrinoless. I'm neutrinoless. I'm atless, no? I'm gownless, but this is not a definition. No? Neutrinoless is not a good definition. You should define something because of attributing some property, not some negative statement. Anyhow, this is my problem. So, okay, I'm through with, general discussion. Now I'm doing something a bit technical. I'm sure you know it. So if you want to take a bit of rest or chat a bit, otherwise I go for this. I mean, it's Dirac equation, and it's not... Che facciamo giù? 5 minutes. So I think we can resume. So as you have seen, you know, the first part is the idea was to cover this definition of what is a neutrino, the particle associated to lepton through the charged current interaction to the weak decays, and stressing that this fact of the standard model is not a fact, that the neutrinos are massless, are not massless. And tomorrow we discuss better somehow the technicalities, and this laws of lepton number is not on that sound ground as we might think, consider the standard model and on that. Now we begin to somehow to trim a bit, to add a bit of formalism. Now discussing things that you know, I'm sure you are, most of you know perfectly. However, since quantum field theory that we use typically is thought to deal with quantum electrodynamics, where you have or quarks, or I mean, usually baryon number or quark conservation is somehow warranted, while for neutrino this is not necessarily. The formalism might be a little bit different. So somehow it's not very different, but let me just stress the point. Most likely it will be easy. So insights on Dirac equation, which describe relativistic or non-relativistic fermions. To reason about neutrinos. So Dirac equation is essential, but it was developed initially for atomic physics. So somehow this was the bridge to, a relativistic situation. In atomic physics, instead, the motion is slow. No, I'm sure you can check that the velocity of electron around an atom is non-relativistic for light atoms, at least. In fact, originally, Dirac was not... somehow, his main point, the main point of this paper, you can read it there. By the way, he was 20 or 21 at this age, in this time, was the spin of the electron. So somehow the fact that the electron has spin, which was realized with a little bit of difficulty in the past year, was in a sense a surprise. Then Pauli improved Schrödinger equation by adding a coupling between magnetic moment of electron and the magnetic field, while, as you see, no, Dirac is rejoicing because he proved that spin is a necessary property of electron. So he says, in my if my frame of discussion, if my model, if my theory is correct, you cannot avoid the spin. So in a sense, I can prove as a theorem inside my theory that you have a particle, not only the connection between the spin and magnetic moment is fixed and it is as predicted, as measured, this G minus G equal to Landé factor. So this was the main point of the paper. It was not antimatter. This was the point of the paper. So to begin to understand the neutrino, it's useful to deepen at least three aspects, in my view. No, but there are aspects that you know already, but we will cover with a little bit different emphasis. So Lorentz structure, where I will emphasize a paper of Weyl, which is published 1 year after the paper of Dirac, the treatment of neutral fermions, which is a discussion that we owe to Majorana. And then a few remarks concerning what antiparticles are in this wave equation. Somehow, I will, in a sense, repeat something that you know perfectly, but with a little bit different, presentation. Now, spin or relativity. Now, let's consider the usual spin or in, B spin or that we use in quantum mechanics. So, if we have a spin or we would introduce this with half angle. Implementation of rotation. So this is how you represent the infinitesimal rotation. You know that we have this half angle when you deal with the spinors. And then we can define a scalar and a vector combination. So this is a so-called tensor product. And then you may check, for instance, that a vector is a vector. So somehow this current constructed with two spinors, or maybe the same spinor taken twice, does transform infinitesimally just as a real vector in ordinary space with the three Euler angle. You can check it if you want. Now, you know that in relativity we have also boost. Not only we have, say, rotation in space, but rotation in space-time. No? So boost is a transformation which involves space and time. Now, the representation of spin. Here I'm discussing Weyl formalism. So this is the first point. So this is basically the theory of Weyl, where you can produce a spinor with two components. So Weyl spinor are spinor with two components. And I mean, in a sense, Dirac made, a big case for the four spinor, no? And this is the useful thing for electrons, which have some mass, and we are interested to deal with the rest frame and all that. On the other hand, if you just care of Lorentz invariance, you do not. You may say, I can build a spinor, a two-component spinor, which is a legitimate object. Now you may check that with this definition of a transformation, you see the only difference with the previous equation is that. Before you have I and a parameter theta, the three Euler angle, which are three real parameter. For those of you who like mathematics, this is Lie group. Lie group have a real parameter, and here are three with I. Sigma are Pauli matrices. Nobody complain. I assume that we agree that sigma is the universal symbol for Pauli matrices. I mean, it's a symbol. Now, we have three more parameter, eta, and are introduced like that. So you may check that, in fact, this group, this algebra, this infinitesimal transformation with six parameter, indeed are the most general 2x2 matrix. It's called linear group. So I mean SL2 in mathematics. If you have a matrix which is just invertible, it has six parameter, 3 plus 3. Now, SiO3 and SiO2 correspond the Lorentz group SO13 correspond to SL1 SL2 on the complex say number for the case. Anyhow, okay, this is detailed mathematics. Now, if we take this definition, you play with the same scalar and vector, you will see that the scalar, which is the time-like object in a sense, mix with the vector. So this is like the time and space are connected through the parameter, the velocity or the rapidity. And the vector gets transformed like that. So these are, in fact, the transformation we would assign to time and space in the infinitesimal form. Okay? So the representation of Lorentz group in the spinorial 2x2, while, etc. You can check it if you never did it. Now, however, let me stress that you have two possibilities, in fact, and just take care of say, the algebraic plus and minus there. So these are two inequivalent representations. You may have a spinor where the boost is represented like this or with the opposite sign. And the two are not equivalent. But both of them correspond to this well-known fact. Okay? So there are two types of Y spinor. Okay? Okay. Che ho fatto? Ok, summary, spinor e relativi. There are two types of B-spinors. So we better think, I mean, it's easier to think in terms of four vector, that is this tensor product thing, defining them like that, with plus and minus, I mean, with a different representation, we define them, and both of them can be presented like that. So, I mean, you have this omega mu nu, this six parameter and this symmetric tensor with six parameter, which realize the Lorentz group. So this is, in a sense, a proof that we can have two type of spinor, okay? I'm just proceeding mathematically without, let's say, trying till now to understand. Now, in order to get a little bit better the physical sense of this position, let me introduce now a Lagrangian density, which describe this kind of field. No, I mean, Lagrangian density we already had in the time of Maxwell, so somehow this was describing the electromagnetic field. Now we are describing the Y field, okay? And then we have this position, psi, psi dagger, et cetera, with sigma mu, defined like this, sigma zero is just the identity, 2x2, and sigma, this one are the usual Pauli matrices. Now, the corresponding wave equation is this one. I sigma mu, this four-dimensional type of sigma, the derivative, the partial derivative, psi. Okay, now the proposal of the revision exercise is that you can check that this, now this is so important that we'll do it together. So this wave equation corresponds to the propagation of a particle with positive velocity. I tell you what we should do and why I think it can be evident. Now, sigma zero is just identity, okay? So sigma zero di zero is just the derivative with respect to time. I dt, I dt psi is, I mean, the beginning of a Hamiltonian. The rest, I dt psi, should be equated to the Hamiltonian times psi. And what's the Hamiltonian? Hamiltonian is sigma, Pauli sigma, time gradient. Okay? Gradient is momentum. Okay, according to quantum mechanics, the derivative with respect to space, with some sign and all that, is the operator of momentum. H is one, okay, with this we know. So that this equation indeed is describing spinor where the helicity is fixed and mass is zero. So this is the equation. So the equation of Weyl is suited to describe an antineutrino, for instance, in this case, positive helicity. Okay. You play with the other representation, you can have negative helicity. So somehow already in 29, it was possible to describe a neutrino. People was not interested. In 29, neutrino was not even conceived. Okay. But the mathematics was there. By the way, Weyl was a genius. Now, neutral particle. Let me discuss next topic. So, okay, this is all for Weyl theory. Now, let me discuss a bit neutral particle. No, we know from, say, university lecture that we have a neutral particle, so photons, pi zero, which coincide with their own antiparticle. So somehow, if you say, what's an antiphoton? An antiphoton is a photon. Okay? So, I mean, it's not that, you don't say antiphoton does not exist. It's better to say antiphoton coincides with photon, and the same with pi zero. Other neutral particles like neutron or K meson are not the same as their own antiparticle. Neutron and antineutron are distinct. So what I'm telling is simply, so this is a very short, dry statement. We do not know whether neutrino is the same as antineutrino in the sense of Majorana, or it is not. So if we just want to stay on experimental sound fact, we don't know. Open question. So the theory of Majorana, which was proposed in 37, can be stated very simply in a specific choice of gamma matrices, or as it is usually told, in a representation of Dirac matrices. You know, you can write Dirac matrices in different bases and they have different appearances, okay? Now, in the representation of Majorana, things are simple for making a statement on this hypothesis. And in his representation, the field, I mean quantum field, psi is the same as psi star, just as for the photon, no? So when you say the photon is a real field, A equal A star, A dagger, if you want, correspond to the statement that photon and antiphoton is the same particle. Okay? With a specific choice of Dirac matrix, this statement is similarly easy for neutrinos. Okay? Now, since people who work on neutrino are acquainted with this representation, the other one usually are not. I don't know in our case, so I just cover a bit this theory. But let me say before what is the general statement. No? So in a general representation of Dirac matrices, the statement of Majorana is that the field is identified with the charge conjugate field. So you have, in a sense, psi star with a bunch of matrices, some gamma zero, some C matrix, which is a unitary matrix, which is, in a sense, you say, in the general representation, I should know a matrix which allows me to make this statement fair. I mean, because this has some transformation property, this one has some transformation property. I mean, the charge conjugation matrix is such that if this is a spinor, this is also a spinor. The previous statement, no, this psi equal psi star, requires that the matrices which implement the Lorentz group are real. I mean, you should have a representation of Dirac matrices such that the I sigma mu nu is real. And this is Majorana, okay? Let me propose an exercise on Majorana spinor. Maybe this is a bit difficult. Okay, I propose the exercise, then maybe we discuss. Now, above there is the definition of what is a self-conjugate spinor. So this is a Majorana spinor, a spinor such that it is the same as chi. This is the same statement which is here. Psi equal charge conjugate. That is written there with some shorthand. Okay, so the exercise is assuming that you have an ordinary Dirac field psi. I mean the one we are acquainted with the usual manipulations, you can define, you can replace psi with a couple of self-conjugate spinors. You should define, say, find the mathematical definition where a Dirac spinor is written in terms of two Majorana spinors, eh? And then the Dirac mass term, the usual one in the Lagrangian density, psi bar psi, is written like that, is really the same, but with this spinor chi and m over 2. This factor over 2 comes about because in a sense, chi and chi bar is the same particle, so it's a combinatorial factor, basically. Okay, so I just challenge you to find this definition, with knowing a bit about charge conjugation. I will give you references for that. So another exercise is this. So suppose that you have a spinor which is chiral. So with left spinor, we know standard model. This we are acquainted to writing something like this. The projector over left state is the same. Find what is the chirality of the conjugate of the chiral field. So if you have a left field, what is the chiral property of this conjugate? Is it left? Is it right? It is what? Okay, this is a bit difficult, I mean technical. Now, this is last point, this is maybe more interesting because suppose that you have a Majorana spinor, which is a self-conjugate. So in a sense, it's a real field, okay? No surprise, it will not carry charge. No, I mean, we know that we are acquainted to the vile idea that you need to have a complex field in order to carry charge. No? Suppose you have a real field, it will not have charge. Correspondingly, there is no current. Current is zero. So you should be able to prove that if a particle is a field is self-conjugate, its vector current, which would couple to photon, is zero. You cannot couple to photon. Even magnetic moment is zero. Mathematically, just playing with the Majorana property. So now, this is more technical than things that I discussed before. So why I'm proposing something which is, so till here I discussed something so smooth and now so somehow so challenging. Just to tell you, if you know charge conjugation, it's fine. If you don't know, please know it. Okay, next point. I will give you references and we can discuss together with Blackboard. Now, this is even more fun. So in a sense, antiparticle, no? So we know that antiparticle exists. We are taught, we have a lecture about that, no? But what are the theoretical arguments in favor of antiparticle? Let me cover two of them. So one is by Feynman. So Feynman, in a lecture for a celebration devoted to Dirac, discuss its argument in favor of antiparticle. So he says, suppose you have an electron, for instance, which propagates, it meets some scattering center, which changes its direction, as depicted there, and then it goes back in the previous direction. No? Now, let me just stress that the meaning of this Feynman diagram, this line, corresponds to the rays of optics. So, this is telling which is the direction of propagation of a wave. So, in a sense, these lines do not correspond to a billiard ball propagating, but this is just the direction the wave is moving. So, you may think of the fronts of the wave, which are orthogonal to the rays. No? Okay? Now, interestingly, it is possible to find, if you are in a relativistic contest, a frame where the two scattering, the time of the two scattering episode are in the opposite direction. So, I mean, it is not true that that you get a contribution only when you are, how can I say, time-like or space-like, I never remember, you say, is time-like, right? Just time-like. even a space-like GET contribution, and then going in the other frame, you will find an electron propagating in opposite direction of time. No? Okay? So then the conclusion of Feynman is not that, so he says, this is annoying. So he says, I do not like the idea that particle may propagate in the opposite direction, so that I may be led to admit that the description of this second situation corresponds not to an electron going back in time, but to a particle which I have to admit, which is with opposite charge, which instead moves forward. So he says that in order to avoid this concept of particle propagating backward in time, I like better to admit that I have antiparticle propagating forward. So I replace this, unpleasant concept with another concept which I may find more pleasant. So it's very fun as a idea, but it's not that different as Feynman does. Okay, so introducing antiparticles allow you to have, say, in a sense, this kind of ordinary type of propagation. Let me show you another instead argument for that, which is instead is closer to Stuckelberg, the Swiss physicist. So formal origin of antiparticle. Now it's more formal and maybe it's even more clear. Now let's buy with the vial this prescription that the introduction in a Hamiltonian of the interaction with the electromagnetic field is due to so-called generalized momentum. No? So you replace the four momentum, P mu, which is I d mu, it is written there, I h d mu, okay, with this combination of the charge of the particle Q and the four potential of the electromagnetic field. So somehow you take I don't know, P square over 2m, the Hamiltonian is, I don't know, the one of Schrödinger, H equal P square over 2m, you replace P with this curly P, and you get magically the interaction of a particle with the electromagnetic field. Let's discuss then a couple of examples. So first one is so-called Klein-Gordon equation, no? So somehow this is a wave equation which evidently respects Lorentz symmetry, no? So if you postulate that P square is equal to M square, no, I respect Lorentz symmetry. I describe the fact that I have a particle with mass M, and I can obtain a wave equation of a particle without spin. Okay, Klein-Gordon theory, you know it already. Now, once I replace the momentum with the generalized momentum, this is the Klein-Gordon equation, including the effects of electromagnetic interaction. Now, the outgoing, so if I have a particle if phi is the wave function of the particle, the outgoing wave that according to quantum mechanics is phi star, no, the conjugate of the other particle, does satisfy automatically the equation where Q is opposite. I mean, you just take this equation, you take the conjugate, you remember that A is real, Q is real, P is purely imaginary, and you see that from this equation you get this one. Okay, so this proves us that the ingoing wave has a charge, the outgoing wave has opposite charge. So, I mean, the two are connected. So, you see, from this, you get this one. So, then, if we talk in terms of this old language, no, this negative frequency, negative energy, no? So, what's negative energy, negative frequency? So, the equation, when you search for energy eigenstate of the Hamiltonian or of the wave equation, you postulate that the the behavior with time is periodical, no? So is to I, e to minus I, e t over h bar, okay? So this is the normal, this is called the positive energy, positive frequency, because energy and frequency are connected according to Einstein, okay? Now, the first equation has positive and negative frequency. However, I can interpret the negative frequency or negative energy as particles with opposite charge. Okay, so in a sense, this wave equation, inside the wave equation, without need of introducing quantum field concepts, already in the context of wave equation, we see that antiparticle have a role. Now, let me do the same for a Dirac equation. I just repeat the same steps. So this is Dirac equation, P slash equals zero, where I have this generalized momentum. Now I use, and here is the Majorana, the definition of what is a Majorana representation is the one when the gamma matrices are purely imaginary, okay? I'm making somehow a statement that a representation exists such that the gamma matrices are purely imaginary. We'll see this better. Now, assuming that it exists, we just repeat the same steps. Psi star obeys the same equation, but we flip it into minus q. So in this representation, we see again the appearance of antiparticle. Negative energy can be thought as outgoing waves of particle with opposite charge. Okay, exercise. Now, since I somehow told you somehow, say, by authority, the existence of this representation, we better check it. I mean, if you did not see it in advance, maybe we can do it. Now, we know that in the case of Dirac equation, we need to deal with the 4x4 matrices, not 2x2, okay? But there is a way of going from 2 to 4, which is shown there in this bluish cartoon, no? So I can introduce this sort of tensor product, no, between 2x2 matrices, no? So this matrix N tensor product with them is just a copy of the matrix M weighted with the elements of the matrix N, okay? So this is a way of engineering construction of 4x4 matrices, okay? So then, consider as candidate of gamma matrices this combination of Pauli matrices. So sigma product sigma or I sigma product sigma. There are many of them, okay? Let's use them as, candidates, okay? Ignoring the sign. So now we know, and I assume you know it, that gamma zero is Hermitian, okay? While the special gammas are anti-Hermitian. So gamma zero is gamma zero dagger. Gamma I dagger is minus gamma I, okay? So this we know. Then using this constraint, let's check which of this part of these matrices could be candidate for gamma zero or candidate for the special gamma I. Then show that the possible form, for instance, so this is somehow a guided exercise, that the form of gamma zero could be sigma 2 times sigma A, where A and B is 0, 1, 3. So the A runs over the real matrices, sigma 0, sigma 1, sigma 3, while sigma 2 is purely imaginary. You remember, no? That Dirac matrices sigma 2 is imaginary. Okay, then check, and while those for gamma, for the vector part, for the special part, are this one. A common choice, so I give you some tip, is to select gamma 0 equals sigma 1 by sigma 2. Find the other one and check whether this choice is unique or there are more possibilities. Okay? So it's let's play to be Majorana. Let's play the game of repeating the step Majorana did. Okay, how we use it? Okay, this is the end of the, let's say, technical part. Now just somehow to show you where we are going to hit. So I discussed something which is even a bit more advanced using standard model language. Let me show you how we use this. So above there is emphasized the hypothesis that neutrinos are massive. So I'm describing a neutrino chi I with Majorana mass and a certain mass mi, m1, m2, m3. Okay. Now, chi is a Majorana field. How we construct a Majorana field with the usual one of the standard model? Here is the somehow the way. Here is the trick. So, and this ni l are the field describing electron, mu and tau neutrino. Okay. Then I assume that there is a unitary matrix, which is called mixing matrix, which is the same as Silvestrini discussed for quarks, but is the different parameter. This is the one for leptons. So I assume that this massive state is a linear combination of the fields of fields with given flavor, okay? Electron, mu, and tau, okay? Then, in order to construct a real field, I take the charge conjugate. So you see there, here is the first part of the assumption. Then I construct its conjugate, charge conjugate. This is a Majorana field, legitimate one. And then I just plug this in the previous, so in the Lagrangian density, which describes the mass of neutrino, and I will have an awful looking Lagrangian density, which, however, is the way to describe the Majorana mass with the ordinary field of the standard model. Okay? So, I mean, in a sense, when we write the standard model, we say, okay, standard model predicts neutrino are massless, basta, ciao. Now, once we believe that neutrinos are massive, we postulate mass is there, we define most general position of what a Majorana field could be, and then we can write a term which is Lorentz invariant description, which is called the Majorana mass. No? And also, I mean, you may also check that what was a diagonal mass matrix, M1, M2, M3, becomes a general complex and symmetric matrix describing a neutrino. So in a basis of flavor, the Majorana mass is a 3x3 matrix, which is non-diagonal. It's complex, it's symmetric, but nothing more than that. Okay, this is just to tell you that this kind of some of technology we have discussed today can be directly used. Okay. Last point, so this is again a consolidation exercise. So review the representation of Dirac matrices. You are certainly acquainted to the so-called Dirac or non-relativistic, Weyl or ultra-relativistic, and now we have also Majoranas. So obtain the explicit form of charge conjugation matrix. You may find in book, even in Wikipedia, I realize it, but I mean, just to understand it once, and find the value or the expression of the chirality matrix gamma 5, which is different in the various. Then write down the equation of motion of a free fermion, and compare with the one of two fermions. Okay, fine. So references, I just give you some, most of them are on web already. So there is all the review by Alessandro Strumia and myself, which is supposed to cover a lot of things on neutrino, and many people told me that it's okay. So this is instead a more discussional paper on what is matter, with a lot of emphasis on Majoranas or charge conjugation and all that. Maybe this could be, it's much more readable, and I published it recently. Then there is this we will need tomorrow. So it's a chapter of a book, but this chapter is on web. It's a lecture on neutrino oscillation. So somehow it's very didactical. And I'm very happy because I wrote this paper. In the PhD I was coordinating in L'Aquila. So I was asked to write a chapter of a book. I do not want to write a chapter of the book, but I want my student to do some exercise. So I told, why not we write a chapter of a book? So, and this is what we did. So in a sense, we checked all detail. I think that is more clear and all that. Va bene, mi sa che ho finito. Va bene, okay. So if we want to discuss, take rest, have other coffee, I'm here. I will be here, so I'm, yeah. Okay, but by the way, let me tell you something fun. So, I was stolen my luggage, no? So where I had my glasses, I can see at some 2 meter, 3 meter maybe, I just see some shadow there. I see maybe some people is there. So, if we come together and we go to Blackwell, I'm much happier because, I can see you, but my apologize, I do not see you very well. Grazie.